a very important oration that is called Dr. S. Armugam Endowment Oration. I invite Dr. Sahul Amit and Dr. Aravind to be a chairperson for this oration. A few words about Dr. Sahul Amit. Dr. Sahul Amit is a very good ENT surgeon, a very good practitioner at KK Nagar. Even the COVID issues, the COVID pandemic, everybody is afraid to do practice. But Sahul Amit is a frontline warrior for discharging the best medical service to the humanity. I welcome Dr. Sahul Amit and also Dr. Aravind. He's a professor of medical gastroenterology. I know Dr. Aravind, when Aravind and myself were a student in Stanley Medical College, when I was a postgraduate at MS General Surgery, then at the time he was a MD post-graduation at Stanley Medicine Department. And wholeheartedly welcome Dr. Aravind also. Then over to Dr. Sahul Amit, then take over the oration.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the kind introduction, sir. And I'm very happy to be a chairperson for this Dr. S. Armugam Endowment Oration. He was also an examiner of medicine for my final year. I'm very happy to be a chairperson for this oration. And a few introduction of Dr. S. Armugam. He was born in Trivandrum district and on 2nd of May 1936. Passed the intermediate examination with the second rank in the state of Travancore, Cochin. Graduated from Trivandrum Medical College in the year 1958, winning gold medals in pathology and medicine for the best outgoing student of Trivandrum Medical College in MBBS batch. Joined Tamil Nadu Medical Service and passed MD General Medicine in 1966. Worked as Assistant Professor of Medicine and Diabetology and medical specialist in, I also medical specialist in ESI Hospital, professor of medicine and diabetology, and finally retired as a director and professor of medicine, Madras Medical College. After 33 years of distinguished government service in various stations and various capacities. Trained in clinical nutrition, diabetology, intensive medical care and research methodology, has published a dozen scientific papers in national and international journals, has organized, chaired, and attended many medical meets, examiner for undergraduate and postgraduate medical examiner for Madras University, Madurai Kamarajar, Bharathidasan, and also Andhra Pradesh University, guide for MD postgraduates for the dissertation for over 10 years. He's a member of Diabetic Association of India, Nutrition Society of India, Indian Society of Electrocardiology, and Association of Physicians of India. Fellow of American College of Chest Physicians, National College of Chest Physicians, and Indian Academy of Medical Specialists and International Medical Science Academy. And we lost our IMA member on 23rd January 2016. With this introduction, I welcome Dr. Aravind, who is a son of Dr. S. Armugam and professor of gastroenterology, to introduce the speaker of this endowment oration. Sir?
Good evening, all. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Aravind Kumar, MSc ENT. He is specialized in endoscopic FIS and endoscopic and skull-based surgery, endoscopic septal correction, microscopic ear surgeries, endoscopic laryngeal surgeries, coablation assisted OSA surgery, etc. Sir did his MBBS 2003 from Vinayaka Mission, Salem, and MSCNT from Meenakshi College, Kanchipuram. And he has got his fellowship in endoscopic skull-based surgery 2016-17 under Dr. T.N. Janakiraman, who incidentally happens to be my classmate at Royal Pearl Hospital, Trichy. And sir has presently is a consultant in ENT surgeon and skull-based surgeon at Vijaya Hospital, Chennai. He has various publications, and more importantly, he has authored a chapter in GNPAF in TM publications, as well as he has published a book on step-by-step approach to endoscope and skull-based surgery. And he has attended various conferences throughout the country, and he has participated as live workshops as faculty throughout India. And many international workshops also he has attended as guest faculty, as well as a visiting consultant in Singapore, Sri Lanka, Taiwan, etc. And of course, 2 years back, he has spoken in our CME also. And I request you kindly, sir, to give a talk on antimicrobial resistance, ENT perceptive. Over to you, sir, please. Over to you, sir, Professor Arvind, sir.
Hello. Thank you for the introduction, sir. It is my honor to do Dr. Arguman sir's oration. I would like to thank the IMA Kodambakkam for having me in this talk, 449th IMA conference. So my topic, can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Yeah. My topic will be on antimicrobial resistance. I will be talking on ENT perspectives. So what problem happens? So these are all the antibiotics which have been identified till date. The antibiotic was very useful during the Second World War time and on. So it prevented the soldiers from infections. So wounded soldiers were all, they were preventing deaths. So as penicillin was identified in 1942, the resistant strains of penicillin started developing from 1940s after the identification of penicillin itself. So this has been a serious problem till now. Since then, the identification of antibiotic has increased. Recent past times after 2011, the antibiotic identification has totally reduced because of this resistant patterns. So these are all the common current resistant problems which is present. The MRSA, methicillin resistant Staph aureus, the vancomycin resistant enterococci, the penicillin intermediate or resistant streptococcal pneumoniae, the extended spectrum beta lactamase producing enterobacteriae, carbaminase producing enterobacteriae. These are all causing a serious problem. For example, if the patient is resistant to a certain kind of antibiotic, even a hip replacement is going to cause a lot of problem. So what you have to do? You have to treat only the bacterial infections. So you have to diagnose your problem properly. So proper diagnosis, if it is bacterial infection, you give antibiotics. So severity, it depends on severity also. If the infection is very less, a topical antibiotic is enough. You need not prescribe an antibiotic itself. So your dosage should eradicate the bacteria, or it should reduce the bacteria. Always there will be a local resistant pattern. So all of you will be practicing. So you will all know what are the local resistant patterns. So you should utilize the pharmacokinetics and dynamic to effective choice of drug and disease. You should know the local resistance, efficacy, and cost. So cost factor also plays a vital role. You should encourage the patient compliance. You should prescribe empirically, but you should prescribe intelligently. So it is just pointless taking antibiotics for cold and flu. Only for bacterial infection. So the acute respiratory tract infections, when are antibiotics indicated? So the clinicians prescribe antibiotics for a viral respiratory tract infection is 40 to 50% of them prescribe antibiotics, which is not necessary. Most common respiratory tract infection is by a virus. The clinician and the patient evaluation is vital for reducing the improper antibiotic use. What the patient does is it goes to a pharmacist. The pharmacist gives antibiotics. He gives for 2 days. So what happens is the resistant pattern develops because the antibiotic dosage which is given by them is not sufficient. So you have to correctly give the antibiotic for appropriate time only if it is indicated. So the accuracy, the diagnosis, and severity is the key. treat with antibiotics only when the bacterial infection is proven or strongly suspected. If you suspect a bacterial infection, you then prescribe a antibiotic. Otherwise, antibiotic prescription is not necessary. Coming to ENT perspective, so I will be touching on a few of the ear conditions. I will be talking about acute otitis media and acute sinusitis and pharyngitis. So I'll be telling all the patterns what we use. So 2/3 of the child, the episode of AOM happens before the third birth. Around every child will pass through this. Every 2/3 of the child. The prevalence of AOM in India is about 43%. The peak incident of infection occurs in 6 to 12 months of age. So what are the most common bacteria which is causing the acute otitis media are Haemophilus influenza, Streptococcus pneumoniae, and Moraxella catarrhalis. So viral, the AOM typically proceeds after a viral infection. Viral upper respiratory tract infection via the eustachian tube, it goes to the middle ear, causing the acute otitis media. Few of them, what they do is when the patient is having upper respiratory tract infection, when the patient is having nose block, they give oxymetazolin, xylometazolin to reduce the stuffiness of nose. I feel that should not be prescribed, because what it does is it reduces the congestion, as well as the eustachian tube is more horizontal in children. So that is why it is more, AOM is common in children. What it does, it is increases the size of the tube, it decongests the tube, so the infection easily passes through the ear. So I request to reduce the use of oxymetazolin after when you have a patient with viral upper respiratory tract infection. So diagnosis is the main criteria for antibiotic usage. So the patient should have acute symptom of infection. There should be ear inflammation, such as tympanic membrane. If you see the tympanic membrane is red, erythematous. So the tympanic membrane is bulged. When the stage of resolution, there are stages in acute otitis media. So when that happens, discharge starts coming from the ear, which is, could be coming with blood stain. So when is antibiotic recommended? When the child is less than 6 months, under 2 years of age, which has recurrent episodes, usually according to the American Society Academy, what they do is they wait for 2 days. 2 days they watchfully wait. If it does not settle down, they start on antibiotics. So more severe symptoms like pyrexia, vomiting, irregular course, any signs of complications are there, you can prescribe antibiotics. When there is high risk individuals like Down syndrome and congenital ear anomaly, you can prescribe on antibiotics. When the patient fails to improve of 2 to 3 days, then you should change your antibiotics, because the resistant patterns, as I've told you, you should know the resistant pattern in a certain locality. The national guidelines recommended for all episodes should be treated. So this is given in our book right now. So what they recommend is the amoxicillin remains the first choice for most centers. So the recommended dose of amoxicillin, because of the resistance, have increased. So now in acute otitis media, according to our prescription, it is around 80 milligrams per kg per day. If it is sensitive, penicillin sensitive, you can supply, give amoxicillin, you can give on cefuroxime. If it is a beta lactamase inhibiting, you can combine with amoxiclav. So according to American Academy of Pediatrics and American Academy of Family Practice, they tell that the macrolides are more tempting because it is given for a shorter time, only a day of treatment is indicated, you should always go for penicillin. Unless the patient is allergic to penicillin, you should not go for macrolides as a first line of treatment. Coming to acute bacterial rhinosinusitis. So bacterial rhinosinusitis, you should have these key features to tell that it is a bacterial infection. Discolored nasal discharge, which is usually unilateral in predominance. Severe unilateral local pain. So there will be unilateral facial swelling, pain, and the patient will be febrile, double sickening, discoloration after initial phase of illness. So after the viral infection, the bacterial infection can set in. So what are the guidelines for empirical antibiotic usage? So what are the guidelines? Is they say that you have to use you can use amoxiclav as a first line rather than a respiratory fluoroquinone. The co-amoxiclav rather than amoxicillin alone is recommended as an empirical antibiotic therapy. So as I told you, the dosage of amoxicillin has increased. As in adult, we now prescribe 1 gram BD for 7 days. So this is a modified score for pharyngitis. So modified center score we call for streptococcal pharyngitis. These scores will help you to identify whether this is a bacterial infection. So presence or absence of cough, you score it as 1. Tender anterior cervical node, temperature is there. Tonsillar exudate on swelling, the tonsils will be enlarged and tonsillar exudates will be there. So yellowish exudates, white color exudates, age predominance. According to that, we maintain a score, and cumulative score we treat according to that. So these are the differentiative features from acute bacterial pharyngitis from viral pharyngitis. So the bacterial pharyngitis presents with edema. There will be enlarged tonsils. Right now, in COVID situations and all, you'll be seeing a lot of patients with throat pain. So the patient might present with throat pain, saying I have a severe throat pain. So it is very difficult to see in these situations. So generally, what I do is I ask the patient to record through phone and ask me to show the recording of the video. I would like to share an incident, because one patient, around 13-year-old boy who had a severe throat pain, who was febrile. That boy was treated with antibiotics, amoxiclav, for 2 weeks or so. He did not recover. They did not see the throat properly. The child was having acute tonsillitis. It had the exact sign. It had necrotic purulent exudate. There were enlarged lymph nodes. These are all the signs. Enlarged tonsil was there. So this made me easy for making the diagnosis. So when there is a viral origin, usually they present with conjunctivitis, sneezing, rhinorrhea. The patient will be present with cough, exabnus, and papillovascular lesion. So how do you treat the back? You can give antibiotic therapy or mucolytics therapy. So according to the survey of antibiotic resistance, I'll be sharing you a few details. So this this is a study which was done for Streptococcus pneumonia, influenza, and Moraxella catarrhalis. This was done around from 2002. The 100 strains for Streptococcus pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza was collected, and it was analyzed through various breakpoints. The breakpoints are a clinical and laboratory standard institute, UCOST European Committee, and pharmacokinetic and dynamic study. So in this study, from which was held from 2012 to 14 for Streptococcus pneumonia, the green indicates 90 to 100% susceptibility. The yellow indicates 75 to 90%. Less than 75% indicates very poor susceptibility. Here, the penicillin group, according to the CLSI, the Clinical and Laboratory Standard Institute, showed the penicillin and amoxiclav has shown more than 90% susceptibility. According to the UCAS study, the penicillin, the amoxiclav was not study was not done. Penicillin was done, which with the high dose showed very good susceptibility. According to pharmacokinetics and dynamic, the amoxiclav showed very good susceptibility in Streptococcus pneumonia. In Haemophilus influenza, from 2012 to 14, 135 isolates were taken. Both showed the cephalosporin and the penicillin group showed very good susceptibility in clinical laboratory standard institute. So in European society, the ampicillin and amoxiclav showed very good susceptibility rate. The cefixime showed 85%. In pharmacokinetic and dynamic, showed the amoxiclav and the cephalosporins with high susceptibility. So in Moraxella, 61 isolates were study was done from 2012 to 14. This showed the amoxicillin. If you see in all the studies, the amoxicillin and cephalosporin were more susceptible antibiotics for all the infections. So I will just go through what are the type of resistance which happens. It is divided into intensic and acquired resistance. What is intensic resistance? See, for example, in 1984, two members of the Arctic expedition, which was explored by Captain John Franklin. In 1845, this was done, and their body was dug after 100 years, and they found that it was the organism which was taken from there was resistant to chlamydia and second generation cephalosporin. This is an example of intensic resistance, because these bodies are not exposed to any of the antibiotics for getting the resistance. This is a characteristic of cell wall or metabolism. What is acquired resistance? The organism becomes resistant to antimicrobial agent to a class which it was previously susceptible to. So when you give a substantial dose, when the patient take out-of-counter medicine, this is common. This can transfer resistance from organism to organism, result of randomly occurring spontaneous mutation. So there are two types of transfers which happens, the vertical and the horizontal type. The vertical type, what it does is, it the same organism, when it replicates, the susceptibility of that organism, it removes the susceptible organism, susceptible isolates, and it goes on growing. So this is what happens. This what the mutation will pass on from organism with every cell division of that organism alone. It will not pass its strains to other organism or the strains of the same organism. So the other type is the horizontal transfer. This is the most worrying type, because this can go from strain to strain or from different organism. For one organism to different organism, it can pass on. It does in this manner. So what are the mechanism? So what mechanism it does is alteration of removal of antimicrobial target. So when the antimicrobial all the antibiotics will come and act on a specific site, so the alteration or removal of target will render them inactive. Alteration of the drug, they alter the drug. So for example, beta lactamase, it binds on the beta lactam and it inactivates it. So alteration of drug access to its target. So alteration of drug, what happens as soon as the antibiotic comes in, through the efflux pump, it pushes outside. This by alter modified drug target, when the drug target is modified, when the antibiotic is inactivated by the enzyme. So that is why when amoxicillin, when it is given, it is resistant, it is combined with amoxiclav. So as I told you, alteration of antimicrobial target, so the MRSA protein binding to will not allow any beta lactam agent. So this I have all explained. So how do you control antimicrobial resistance? You control by understanding the resistant patterns quickly. You should, surrounding resistant patterns, you should understand quickly. Ensuring antibiotics are prescribed when needed. Only when needed, you prescribe antibiotic. Or you should prescribe a correct agent, correct amount of time. Improving the infection and prevention and control. You should encourage the development of new antibiotics. Diagnostic strategies are the key. So if you diagnose a bacterial infection or you find out that through some tests that this is a bacterial infection, you can prescribe an antibiotic. These are all the principles. So you should under identify the source of infection. You should identify where the source of infection is, whether it is in the ear, whether it is in the nose or in the throat. Appropriate sampling. You should before prescribing, you should try to take appropriate sampling. For example, if you find that patient is septicemic, you send the patient for take a bacterial culture, take a swab and send for a culture. Source control. You should if you find the source of infection, for example, if there is an abscess, so if you prescribe an antibiotic for abscess, it is not going to take up. So you have to drain the abscess, you have to send that abscess for culture, and then you have to prescribe antibiotics. The choice of initial antimicrobial agent. So initially, when you are prescribing an antibiotic, it should not be a broad spectrum antibiotic. So if you prescribe a broad spectrum, it is going to destroy the flora. And again, if you send for culture, you're not going to get a proper result. You should give an appropriate dose for an appropriate period of time so that the antibiotic does not become inactive. The organism should not overcome the antibiotic. The route of administration. If there is a mild otitis externa, for example, inflammation of the ear. When there is a mild otitis externa, you give a topical antibiotic. And if the infection increases, you can give oral. If very, very high infection, like acute tonsillitis, which is not settling to antibiotics, IV antibiotics. Switch to oral when treatment. What this means is when you... for example, if there is a patient with acute tonsillitis, you are admitting the patient with two or 3 days of IV antibiotics. After that, you should reduce the, you should convert the IV antibiotics into oral antibiotics and discharge the patient accordingly. You should make sure the patient completes the course of treatment. If this doesn't happen, the resistant strain will develop. What you should maximize is therapy should reduce maximal and eradicate a bacterial load. Maximum amount of bacterial load it should eradicate. That is why you are going to give an antibiotic. There is no point giving it for a viral infection. important to distinct. So we come to our conclusion. We should make sure that we distinguish between a viral and a bacterial infection. That is the key. So the diagnosis is the key for giving a proper antibiotic treatment. You should know the local prevalent patterns. Your treatment should eradicate the bacteria. You should know the PK/PKD parameters of that locality, of that drug. Prescription should reduce the antimicrobial load. You should prescribe the optimum antimicrobial. So when you prescribe augmentin, you should keep all this in mind, because the unstable complication is diarrhea. The uncommon effects are mucocutaneous candidiasis, diarrhea in children. So it is contraindicated in patients with hypersensitivity to beta-lactams. When the patient is having renal problem, the augmentin dosage should be adjusted. Septum can produce oral candida, eosinophilia, headache, dizziness, gastrointestinal disturbances, including diarrhea, uncommon thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, skin rashes can happen. In septum is contraindicated in patients with hypersensitivity to cephalosporin, and the patient is allergic to penicillin or beta-lactam should be taken. I thank each and everyone for listening to my talk, and I would thank a chairpersons for giving me such an opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Arvind Kumar, sir.
Thank you very much for your kind explanation.
Thank you.
When you starting an antibiotic for a septic tonsillitis, what stage you convert from a oral to a parenteral drug? Can you hear me?
Sir, your voice is...
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So when you're treating, you rightly said that nowadays corona is there. So instead of seeing the PPE, we cannot see it properly. Take a video photograph or a video of the throat and send it to us so that we can see it properly, whether it is a viral or a bacterial, we can differentiate it. If it is bacteria, we are giving oral therapy with amoxicillin antibiotic. At what stage we have to convert a parenteral?
When the infection subsides, sir.
On any time period you just have it?
For a week time.
For a week, I have to continue with antibiotic. What else?
Yes, sir.
It is a parenteral. What is the drug of choice, sir?
Sir?
It is parenteral. What drug you will use, sir? I think.
Hello?
Connection problem.
I think internet is not connected problem. Can you hear me?
Hello?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Sir, I can hear you, sir.
You heard my question?
Other than parenteral, what you use, you're asking me.
Yeah.
Sir, I use only oral, sir. Oral antibiotics. If it is absolutely necessary, only I use. Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah. I can hear you, sir. Dr. Arvind, sir, any questions from you?
No, sir. Very nice presentation, sir. We can close the session. Thank you, sir.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
I'm Dr. Lakshminarayanan. I just want to know, what are the acute infections of the ear which cause vertigo? And if it is acute infinitis with vertigo, what is the role of antibiotic and cinazine?
Sir, acute infections causing acute labyrinthitis can cause. For example, acute otitis media in few situations, very uncommon situation, can cause vertigo. You have to prescribe with steroids, sir. Antibiotics to reduce the infection with steroids therapy. Hello. Can you hear
me? If you use steroids, we will not flare up bacterial infections.
Sir, we prescribe along with antibiotics dosage, sir.
Oh.
If it is a bacterial cause, if it is a bacterial, yeah. So labyrinthitis can happen without bacterial cause also.
In viral also it can come, you know?
It can come.
Oh. In that situation, what do you do?
Diagnosis is the key. Usually it happens when the patient is having a CSOM, when the patient is having a perforated tympanic membrane. So the infection can easily pass inside and it can affect the labyrinth and cause labyrinthitis.
Okay.
For acute vertigo, you can give beta histidine.
So if ear discharge is there, we can right away take a swab test and culture sensitivity. If it is bacterial, we can give antibiotics. Sir. If it is culture is negative, we can without antibiotic, we can treat.
Okay, thank you.
In this COVID situation, it is, the diagnostic criteria is very difficult. Seeing as the ENT surgeons are the more ENT and the chest physicians are more affected now. So utmost care is needed seeing all the patients.
Yeah, ophthalmic cases also.
Yeah, yes, sir. Yes, ophthalmic also. Because they go close to the eye and examine. Yeah. So a lot of diagnostic criteria and our visualization of the patients are changing right now.
Rightly said, sir. Now they are wearing mask without seeing the throat. Lot of prescribing antibiotics and pharmacy also giving antibiotic. So antibiotic resistance and also undiagnosed cases of tonsillitis, septic tonsil is going on.
Yeah, a lot of cases.
And easily catch it up on seeing the throat.
So what I do, as Amit sir told, I ask the patient to sit outside and take a video. So when the patient comes inside, the patient doesn't talk. I have a two-way mic. So I ask the patient what complaints are there and I ask them to take a video. When the patient comes inside, he shows the camera with the findings. Actually, with the improvement of all the phones and cameras right now, our diagnosis is improving. Usually I use an endoscope. Now I'm not using an endoscope in this situation. Sir, your experience, sir.
I'm doing the same thing. Camera, video recording, and also photos of the throat taken by the patient's attendant or the patient himself brings it. So that's why I think
that is safer, because few patients, when we put a tongue depressor and see, they cough. So it is very difficult because we can't.
No instrumentation, sir. If I use the tongue depressor, disposable one is there, no? That we are using it, not the metal one. Metal one, we have to sterilize here, do that. So disposable, we can use it. Any other questions from the audience, sir? Secretary sir, you can take over, sir.
Secretary sir, illa bolrukku. You request the muted. You carry on. You request the last speaker to come over and take over.
Hello.
Sir, irukkeenga. Okay, go ahead, sir. Sir, mute la irukkeenga.
அவர்
மியூட் எடுக்க சொல்லுங்க.
ஹலோ.
ஆ சரி சார். ஆ
கேக்குதா? இப்ப கேக்குதா?
Go ahead sir.
Yes sir.
Okay okay. Yeah Amanna. Well done Dr. Aravind Kumar because you had delivered a very important and very nice lecture. And before we move on to next session with the permission of our president, we are going to make a small announcement because our treasurer Dr. Chandrasekhar is no more with us, so that we unanimously elected Dr. Sagul Amin as a treasurer in Kodambakkam IME. So I welcome and I congratulate Dr. Sagul Amin as a treasurer in Kodambakkam IME branch. Congratulations, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for selecting me as a treasurer.
You have
do my job with all your cooperation, sir.
You have our cooperation. You have a very great job to do. We wish you will hold this post for as long as Dr. Chandrasekhar held it and continue to amass more wealth than he did for us. Thank you.